Genesis chapter 1 tells us where we get our beginning from. I always love to begin with this because we live in a society where another concept is taking over. That man evolved from somewhere. Our kids go to school. And I see many of them here. And they better know that we have a genesis, we have a beginning. And that beginning began in God. So it's be clear and out there that our beginning is in God. And so in Genesis chapter 1 and verses 1 says, God created the heavens and the earth. So day 1, he said, let there be light. And then there was light. Day 2, let there be firmaments in the midst of the waters and divide the waters from the waters. And so that was day 2. And day 3, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place. And let the dry land appear. And on that same day, he created brought the grass and all the fruits and all the trees that we see. And that was day 3. And day 4, he said, let there be lights in the firmament on the heavens to divide the day from the night. And that is where we have the sun, the moon, the stars, and all that we see during the day and the night. And so that was day 4. And day 5, he says, let their waters abound with the abundance of the living creatures. To have the fish. And the skies to have the birds. And so that's where when we see the fish, we see the birds flying. That was created on day 5. And so day 6. He said, let there outbreak for the living creatures, the creeping animals. And that's where we have the animals like the tigers, the lions, the cows, the goats, and all that one. And those were created on day 6. But it wasn't done. And he said, now I've done all. He said, now let me do one more thing. And chapter 1, verses 26 says, let us make man in our image. Now, I was just giving a prelude of where we come from, how we are here. And so all these things, God has created them. And if you read your Bible well, he says, let it be. And they were there. Let it be. So everything that we see to now, as we have read this verse, was saying, let there be, and they came into being. But verses 26, there became a discussion. He said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. So our creation, our being, our existence.
Obotongi bwaitu okoroga na bwaitu.
A man and a woman.
Omusajja na omukulu.
We are created in the likeness of God. So that we can exhibit what God exhibits. And so after that one, and verses 28, then God said to them, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish, the sea, over the birds of the air, over the every living thing that moves on earth. And so mankind was given the power and the authority to take care of everything that survives on the planet Earth. Let's have dominion over them. It's so amazing that a leaf dominate a man. When man was given power to dominate on everything on earth. You have walked through the inner cities of these countries. Or we come from the villages where we come from. Things like marijuana dominates a man. Heroin dominates man. But these are the things that we were given to have dominion over. It's amazing. A leaf kills a home. But when we were given the power to dominate over them. Anyway, today is Men's Day, so I don't want to go there. We can talk another day there. So, but that's how we all came into existence. And I'm speaking to my little boys and girls who are here, and I'm a father to have a little boy and I have a girl, is that we have a our existence never came from something of a boom and then we came into existence. I mean, they watch various cartoons and various things that they see. And sometimes they can come out of there that they might have just magically came into existence. And so we just have to be very clear to say where we came from. Our existence is in God. And so it is in God that we dwell in. And that's where we need to live in. Proverbs chapter 19 and verses 21. It says, many are the plans in a man's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. So I want us to know and look at the idea. What was the purpose that God created man? Now I'm speaking to men, and men who are here, I know are supported by their wives, are supported by their children, are supported by their fathers or mothers, if our mothers and fathers are alive. So I'm speaking to men who are here, whether you are young, old, and the family together.
As
a man goes, as a man goes, so goes the family, the society, and the world. There is a big responsibility that is laid on men, and which men we are running away from that responsibility. And it's what we are going to look today. What was it that God gave us? There is one conclusion I've come after reading through the Bible. After attending various seminars, after preaching all our churches, this is what I've come to. The greatest spiritual curse.
There's
a social curse, socio-economical curse, and the mental curse in humanity today is fatherlessness. Is a lack of fatherlessness. Either physically or lack of involvement. Is either you are, as a father, you may be there, but you are not involved. Or you have just left your family and you have walked away. And that's why so many problems come in the society. Studies that have been done in this country, it says 92% of the problem the society has is the absence of the father. Whether it's boys with guns killing each other, or girls with unwedded pregnancies, or boys in jail, it is lack of fathers. It is a big burden, man, that has been laid on us. A big burden that has been laid on us. That sometimes we take it lightly. Especially on these young children who are growing up. But we leave them. And they just move around. Sometimes we may be in the house. Sometimes we may be there, but our involvement is not there. And that's what has, one, what has become one of the greatest deceptions. The idea is like, you know, I am there. But there is nothing you are doing. You don't know what they are doing at school. You don't know what they are watching. You just there, provided you are paying for the rent. Provided the cars are functioning. Provided you go to work. You are there. You don't know what these kids are watching. You don't know who they are involving themselves in. When they go to the sports nowadays, because we have Uber, maybe they are whatever ages, you drop them on Uber, somebody drops them, and somebody goes pick them up. We got to be involved in their lives. I say the greatest deception, especially as an animal, because there is another audience where I can say men have gone away. But as men, we are there. We are there. My question is to each and every one of us. Are we involved? Are we involved in the family that we have come in, we have created? So it's very important that we need to see that one. I want us to turn to the book of Genesis, the same Genesis. And let's see when man was created, what was God's plan for this man? So the first thing we see in Genesis chapter 2, verses 8, it says, the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and he put the man whom he had formed. So the first thing that the Bible tells us, us. When man was created in the likeness of God, in the image of God, he took him to the Garden of Eden. I
want to
see archaeologists, those are researchers, who have done research in the Middle East, in Israel and Palestine, so that they can find the real location of the Garden of Eden. To date 2017, there is none who has located that. They have located the Mount of Golgotha, the River Jordan is there, and all these things are there. But the Garden of Eden, there is nowhere. And this is the reason why. The Garden of Eden was not a specific location. The Garden of Eden is an atmosphere. The word Eden in Hebrew, means delight. That's very good. Delight, a place of happiness. And so when God created man and brought him to that place of delight, this is a place of holiness. So the first thing that God did to man is to place man in his presence. Is in his presence. That is the first thing for any man. If ever you are going to leave your family, you need the presence of God. That is the first thing that God did to man. Placed him in his presence. Before he tells him what to do, he wanted him to be in his presence of this holiness. And so if you lack that, you can have much money as you can, you can provide for your children as you can, but then you miss that connection of you and God. So Eden meant the holiness of God, a place of delight. And so women, for us to be impactful to our family, to the society, we need God. I don't know how much I can stress that. We need God. And God does not mean coming to church. You know, sometimes we have some checklist, right? I go to church. I pay tithe. I pay offering. I attend Adventist men. I see. I'm okay. But that is not it. That is not it, because that one can be so deceptive to anybody. But are you meditating with the Lord? Do you have a personal relationship with God? How often do you read God's word? In the course of the day, how often are you in the Word? Because there is no way you can get the connection with God without reading His Word. So the first place that God brought man was in His presence. So for man to be effective and impactful for the society that he's leading, he needs God. I need God to be. It doesn't matter whether it's a title of a pastor, of going to school in a theological school. No! I need my connection, daily connection with my God, so that I can lead my family in the best way possible. So my fellow man, I can use that word, my fellow man, I've been running for 8 years now. I can use that on my field. We need God in order to lead these children who have been placed in us, and the mothers who have been placed in us. So we need that one. Psalms chapter 119. And verses 5. 105. So 105. Your word is a lamp to my feet. And a light to my path. So we need God's word. Remember, let me say a disclaimer. I didn't come here to tell you what you need to do in your home. I didn't come here to tell you you need to help your wife clean dishes. I didn't come here to tell you you need to be cleaning your yard. Because you can be doing all that and still you miss the presence of God. And so I want us to move away from if there are some women who are good cleaning, making good yards than even men. There are some women who can take a mower and go outside and mow that lawn better than men. So I'm not saying that, but I want to say the first things first. Let's be in the presence of God. Let God be our driver. And that is what he did in Genesis chapter 2 and verses 8. He took him to the Garden of Eden. And he placed him there. A place of holiness. That begins the cornerstone of our survival as men. The second thing that God did to man. When we go to Genesis chapter 2 and verses 15, is work. God placed man in the Garden of Eden so that he can work in that garden. Man, we got to work. I don't know, I have not transversed enough in this metroplex. All I know is from the village I come, where you see men hanging in the shopping centers playing games. I have not transversed in this area to know. But I don't know whether there is any man who is just an idler. Who is not doing anything, who expects the wife to be doing everything. I don't know, but here the second thing, after man was placed in the presence of God, was given work. Work is not a curse. There is an ideology that runs out here that after the fall of man, then man was given work. When we are reading Genesis chapter 2, we are not reading Genesis chapter 3. So Genesis chapter 2 is clearly a holy man spoken to. He's been told work. Yes, I have brought you to the Garden of Eden. But your responsibility is work. So as men, we ought to work. Paul says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verses that if anyone is unwilling to work, let him not eat. I grew up in a home of five boys. Four boys and one girl. And all the boys were leading. So the eldest brother is a boy, second one is a boy, third one is a boy, fourth one I'm a boy. So the girl came the last. If there is one thing that I never wanted to do in that home, is to carry corn, which we call maize, to the grinding mill. And always grinding mills were placed in an open area. And so you are a young man, you want to show off in the community, and there you are given mace to carry on top of your head to take to the grinding mill. And each four of us had a turn. If the first, my eldest brother's turn, second born, third born, fourth born. So you had your turn. And you are like, you are begging to see that if somebody could help you. My dad used to say, the only man I know is the one who does not eat. If you don't eat, then don't go. I did that. Even after my form four. You know, you want to be a good boy, and you know, you want to also show up in the shopping center, and there you are.